Well, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Paul Norberg. I'm the treasurer of the Citizens for Vallejo Political Action Committee. And we were formed back in 2010 by a number of Vallejo residents who want to ensure that we have candidates and incumbents that demonstrate leadership qualities that will advance Vallejo's best interests. If time permits, we will take questions from the audience. So we've submitted, some of you have already submitted your cards. If anyone would like a card and hasn't submitted one, you can raise your hand. We'll get you a card.
Anyone else?
And then if you could turn them in at the conclusion of my remarks here. Before we get started, if you could turn off your cell phones to avoid any interruptions. We are pleased to see that we have six of the candidates here tonight, although a number of candidates indicated that they had a prior commitment and could not attend. So for those candidates, it's important for them to get their message out. This has been an opportunity for everyone to make their positions known to the Vallejo community, and we're sorry that they've chosen not to attend. But we're very pleased to see that the six who did attend are here with us this afternoon. We'd like to thank the Springbrook Masonic Temple for the use of their facility today, and to Mark Garman for providing the audio-visual services. We will rebroadcast this on VCAT, and it will also be on the Citizens for Vallejo website at a later date. Our moderator for the first part of the forum is Karima Cara. Karima is a graduate of St. Paul High School in San Francisco. She is also a graduate of the American University in Paris and International House in London, England. She has a law degree from London University in London, England. She is a past member of the Vallejo County Planning Commission and a past member of the Solano County Art Commission. She is president of the California County Planning Commission in 2012 and has served on the Vallejo Planning Commission. She's a past president of the Myra Theater Guild, a member of the Vallejo Waterfront Festival Executive Committee, and she speaks English, Arabic, and French. She lived in Libya, England, France, Turkey, Morocco, Malaysia, and America. She recently left Morgan Stanley to form her own security firm here in Vallejo. Today's forum will take about 4 hours and end at 5 p.m. The first part of the forum, the Mayor Council Forum, will be from 1 until 2:30, and the School Board Forum will be from 3 until 4:30. The questions were developed by the Citizens for Vallejo Board, and none of the candidates have been given the questions in advance. The candidates have drawn random letters to determine the order of their seating, and we haven't pre-selected who will get which question. As time is limited, please hold your applause until after the candidates have made their closing statements. Boos are not acceptable. Our timekeepers today are Dennis Albright and Jane Ferrier. Jane will flash a yellow card when you have 15 seconds remaining and a red card when time is up. Now I'll go over the rules. Each candidate will have the opportunity to respond to 3 general questions and 2 lightning round questions. All candidates will be given equal time to respond. For each question, 3 responses will be solicited. Each responder will have 1 minute to answer. At the close of the general questions, there will be a lightning round. During this round, all candidates will answer the same question, and each candidate will have 15 seconds to respond. As time permits, we will take selected questions from the audience, and during this time, each candidate will have 1 minute to respond, and we will ask the same question of all 6 candidates. Time limits are firm, so please focus your answer on the questions posed. and please do not interrupt or respond to other questions. Following the question and answer session, each candidate will have the opportunity to make a 1.5-minute closing statement. And following the question and answer session, candidates will have the opportunity to stay longer and answer individual questions from the audience. Now I'll turn it over to Karima, I'm sorry, and we'll start the debate.
Can you hear me? Yeah? Okay. Let's. So the first question is going to be handled by Mr. Sampayan first, then Ms. Diaz, and then Ms. Messenheimer. Now, question one. I'll repeat it first, and I'll say it once, and if anyone asks me to repeat it, I can do it again, because I know how complicated it gets. One, how important is community input when considering major projects such as Orsium Marine Terminal or Faraday Future? How would you obtain such input? Mr. Sampayan?
It does work. Thank you for the question. First and foremost, community input is paramount in the way I, as a city council member, I, as a mayor, want to operate. Whenever we have a large development in our community, I truly believe that everyone has a say in how that development should and fit into Vallejo. When you have controversial issues such as VMT Orsum, community input is extremely important, because there are some diverse opinions that folks have out there in the community that need to be said and need to be heard. I'm a listener. I want to hear what my community has to say. It's very important that I, as a decision maker, as a policy maker, knows what the community is concerned about. Without expressing those concerns, without hearing those concerns, how can I make a decision that would be good for our community?
Thank you. Ms. Diaz?
Yes.
Would you like me to repeat the question?
No.
The question's fine.
Good afternoon, everyone. I think community input is vital to any project that's done in the city, county, or at any state or federal level, especially because you want to take into consideration the people that are going to be affected in such projects such as Orsum or Faraday Future. You know, Faraday is on Mare Island. There's one entrance in and one entrance out, so it's going to affect the people that live there quite a bit. And although it's a project that is stated to bring a lot of jobs and a lot of positive things, we still need to hear from the people that are going to be affected, and not just the ones living there, but everybody else. Same thing with Orsum. You know, sometimes we could overlook something, and if somebody has their opinions or their concerns, that's an insight for the people that are making the decisions. As a community organizer and as a person who founded a nonprofit that's a community center, it's very important to include everyone in the decisions that are being made. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Missenheimer, would you like me to repeat the question? Okay. I won't ask that question again. You guys are obviously awake.
So far. One of the things that I've found while working out in the community is that the noticing that goes out from the city oftentimes is very generic. So you'll get a notice to say, this business is coming into town. It may affect your neighborhood. If you have any questions, contact City Hall. Well, people don't really understand what that means. It needs to have more information and detail about how exactly is it going to impact my neighborhood. So we've been trying really hard in different community groups to get the city to try to give more information when they're noticing the public about what type of developments are there. Because once it goes out, then everybody's left to speculate on what it actually means to their neighborhood. And so it's really important that the people who are being impacted by whatever development is coming into town, that they have the details and they have somewhere to go that they can talk about those issues. So what I would like to see on City Council is that we have more meetings, that we bring in the community, and then we actually talk about the issues and answer questions at that time.
Thank you. Question two, and Ms. Missenheimer is number one. and then Mr. McConnell, and then Ms. Rosanna Allegra Vega. And I got that wrong, didn't I? Yeah, thank you. See, even this side is very nervous. Okay. Okay. Number two. Do you agree with the city's current policy on regulating marijuana dispensaries? Why or why not? Ms. Messenheim.
One of the groups that I've spent about 17 years with is the Vallejo Coalition Change, and that was a group of citizens that got together that dealt with alcohol and tobacco issues and trying to set policy within the city. And so what is really important is that we have regulation and enforcement for these type of businesses, because businesses start off with good intent, but sometimes you get business owners that become a little bit slack, or then they have bad ideas on how they're supposed to run their business. So it's important that we have enforcement in place along with the regulation, because we have regulations on the book now, but we don't get that enforcement. And so the money has to be there so that they can go back and check on the businesses, making sure that they're doing the things that they said they were going to do. And part of that is through the taxation that they have in the city. That should be part of education for the business and education for the community, as well as enforcement. So I believe that for these businesses, we want to make sure that we have the money in place that we can go back and check and make sure that they're doing the things that they said they were going to do.
Mr. McConnell.
Thank you. Since I'm one of the ones who was major leader on this, I obviously agree with most of this ordinance already, but it's not perfect, and it needs to be improved. And where it needs to be improved is on the question of land use. We've chosen not to connect a site to a land use. I actually think that's a good idea. We need instead to license the individual holder, because if we connect it to land use, then it becomes a license to be used at that location forever. And that means that somebody else might come in that you might not like. You can't change it if it's there for 10 years and goes away. It can come back in 20 years. That's not the right way to do it. So we need to find a way to hook it to the operator as well. We also need to make sure that we're collecting that money. When the city wanted to stop taking the money, I'm the one who screamed, no, we can't do that. We've now brought in over $1.5 million from those dispensaries. They've proven to be responsible operators, and I will continue to work with them because they've shown that they are responsible citizens. We can work on this together and learn from it. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Verde Allegra, am I doing better? Thank you.
Thank you. Medical marijuana is legal in California. That was passed in 1996 by voters. And in Vallejo, we are the only city that has allowed operation of marijuana dispensaries. It's been passed by the City Council, and I supported the passage of that last year. And because we also passed Measure B, we are collecting taxes, which will amount to about $1.5 million this year. And it's going to increase as the year progresses. I support it because it's legal. I want to make sure that patients get it legally and safely. And also regulation keeps it away from children, and also it keeps it away from, you know, the illegal sales. So I think it's really important that we impose this regulation. There's still a lot of kinks that we need to fix, but it is now in place, and we have about 10 medical dispensaries that are legally operating in our city of Vallejo. Thank you.
Thank you. Question number three, it'll go to Mr. McConnell first, and then Mr. Sampayan, and then Mr. Pendergrass. Okay, question three. Are you in favor of Indian gaming or a casino anywhere in Vallejo? Why or why not?
When this issue arose, I studied it very carefully, and the thing that led me to believe that I'm not in favor of an Indian casino is the fact that you have to turn over control of your land, and thus land use, to the Department of the Interior, Bureau of Indian Affairs. Once you grant that power and control to them, it's gone forever. Casinos are quite different, and they depend upon who operates that. I worked for a casino in Nevada when I was in college. And there were good casinos and bad casinos. It's how they're run. So a casino in and of itself is not necessarily bad, but I'm not in favor of having an Indian casino. And until the state law of California changes, that's the only type you're going to have if you're going to have slot machines or any other type of machinery. Otherwise, it's card rooms, board games, and things of that nature. So if a proper casino came along, I wouldn't be against it, but I would sure be looking at it very, very carefully because I know both the benefits and the dangers that can arise from that type of an operation. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Sampayan?
Thank you. The issue of Indian casinos is a very complicated issue. The first thing that I think about is the land use and how much of that area is actually going to be tax producing to the city of Vallejo. You might have a huge influx of individuals that are coming to gamble, but how much money do we get from that casino? And the answer is little to none. You get it from the surrounding business that might be attracted. Secondly, there is a huge saturation of casinos throughout the Bay Area. As we all know, you can drive just a few miles south into Richmond and there's gaming there. You can go into the Napa Valley, there is gaming there. A lot of these places have failed, in particular the ones that were going to be designed in Richmond. The other issue I have is addiction, gambling addiction, and is that good for our residents and those that are struggling to make ends meet? And my answer to that would be no. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Pendergrass? And welcome.
Thank you. Right now, I don't believe I would favor a Indian casino. For the same reason Mr. McConnell mentioned, it's about the land and giving up our control over that forever. Although I must say that my policy on any business that's applying to do business here in the city of Vallejo is to follow the process. I want to understand the answers to all of the questions that are posed by the citizens, and I want to understand the recommendations made by our staff and study that thoroughly before I make up my mind. I don't think it's fair to business, and I think it creates an anti-business atmosphere when we short-circuit the process. So I would want to study it, and then I would make up my mind what I felt was in the best interest of this community.
Thank you. Okay, question number four. It's going to be handled first by Ms. Rosanna Verde Alegre, and then Mr. Pendergrass, and then Ms. Diaz. Okay, number four. Should the participatory budgeting program be continued? Why or why not?
I supported participatory budgeting from the very beginning. I was actually a delegate on the steering committee about 3-4 years ago before I ran for council. And while I was elected to the council, I voted to support continuation of participatory budgeting. And so I will continue to support it. There are concerns about the number of voters or people that vote for the projects. It has decreased during the last 2 years, and I'm concerned about that too. But I think it's an excellent way of community engagement. And we need to mobilize the community. Again, we have a staff that works with that project to do a little bit more outreach and improvise and be more creative in doing outreach to the neighborhoods. I know that there is low participation from the Latino, Filipino, African-American community, but I believe that we should not just give it up. I think it's an excellent tool to engage community for feedback on projects that mean very much to them. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Pendergrass?
Thank you. I think PB does bring with it community engagement, and I think it's a very positive thing. I just think right now is the wrong time for it. The city has not been able to accomplish what we said we were going to accomplish with the Measure B funds, that is to provide the number of police officers necessary to create a safe environment for our citizens. And we also have not fixed all of our roads. So to take $1 million and set it aside for these other projects, although very worthwhile projects and very well thought out, I think is something we ought to think about. I would rather spend the money now to create a safe city that has provided for all of its infrastructure needs, and then when we have the resources to allow for those investments in the things that our citizens would like additionally, I would be all in favor of that.
Thank you. Ms. Diaz?
Sorry, I didn't have this on prior to my turn. I voted for precipitary budgeting, and I will vote for precipitary budgeting again. I think it's important that we continue with what we've been doing. There's a lot of community engagement that needs to be worked on. I, for one, have been working with the Latino community and have had voting sessions at the Diaz and Loera Centro Latino, so we're reaching out to everyone to engage them in precipitatory budgeting. I know that there's a tutoring program that came of this. I know that there's also a healthy kitchen that was put in place. So there's a lot of things that are not just projects that are for topics that are not going to help people. You know, there's actually projects that are helping the community and the kids in many different ways. And of course, we have the beautification of our city. And if we want to attract new businesses and people to come here, it's nice to go into a city that looks good. So I'm in favor of precipitatory budgeting, and I think that I would like to see it continue. There's been a decline in the people that are voting, but it's a matter of reaching out to them to get those numbers up. Thank you.
Thank you. Question five. First, Mr. Pendergrass. Second, Ms. Mesenheimer. Third, Mr. McConnell. Question five. How will the recently updated general plan impact decisions you may make in future city development proposals? Nobody wants to do that one, do they?
No. Well, I'm fine with it. I really very much appreciate the fact that we have a general plan, and I certainly appreciate all the work that was put in on that general plan by this community to put together a framework for the leadership that's going to be put in place with this election and future leadership groups. So it allows us a guide. So I'm very pleased that we have a general plan and would look to that general plan for guidance with any decision that came before the council in terms of development of this city. I don't believe you can govern appropriately without a document in place that the community has worked on to help you understand the direction the community wants to go. We are the representatives of the community, and that their input is most valuable.
Thank you. Ms. Mesenheimer?
I attended most of the meetings for the general plan update. As a 30-year resident, as many of you have been here for a while, we've watched different developments come and go in the city, and we see the nice pictures and we have an image of where we think we're gonna go, and we haven't seen those materialize. So the general plan update is something necessary, I think, because we finally have a vision about where Vallejo wants to go, and that vision was created by people like us in the community on what we want to see in Vallejo. The plan also goes into areas that have been historically neglected, and it brings up those neighborhoods. I think that's important. South Vallejo is one of the first places people see when they come into Vallejo, and it's important that we start putting economic development in there, and it has to be the right economic development. So this plan offers an opportunity now to be able to put in businesses and industry in areas that are appropriate, and they also give a guidance for what type of businesses that we want to see in Vallejo. So I think it's very important, very in favor of making sure that it continues to go in the direction that the community had intended it to.
Thank you. Mr. McConnell?
Thank you. With a undergraduate and graduate study in public administration, 8 years on the Planning Commission, including 1 year as chair, I have been a big supporter of the general plan. We fought hard to set the funds aside to make that happen. When it finally started happening, I attended all the goal-setting sessions, so a lot of those ideas in there generated from those goal-setting sessions, and I'm proud to say a lot of my ideas came into that plan. It's important because when an applicant comes to do the due process on presenting their project, they look to that general plan to know what is expected of them And then they can come in with an offer that the Planning Commission can either say yes to or maybe improve along the way. So it provides a guideline for future economic development. More especially, what the public will have to pay very close attention to is whether or not we elect candidates now and in the following elections who will have the courage to stick to that general plan and not deviate from it to make it their own personal pursuits, because that would be a huge mistake if that was to occur.
Thank you. Okay, number six, yes? Mm-hmm. Okay, number six. Ms. Diaz, you're number one. Ms. Rosanna Verde Alegra, number two. My Spanish is awful, I'm sorry. I'll get better by the end of the evening. And Mr. Sampayan, three. Okay, question number six. The city needs more high-paying jobs to foster growth. How would you bring more high-paying jobs to the city? Ms. Diaz.
I think that it's important to have high-paying jobs in the city, but I think it's also very important to have jobs that the city can afford. And with that, I mean that we all have a position or an employment that we do, and we get compensated for doing what we do. But if a city doesn't have the necessary revenue to pay for those high-paying jobs, it's going to be very difficult. Now, what I would do is I would reach out and attract people to come and invest, establish and their businesses in the city and grow, and also that way be able to work with the community in finding jobs that are adequate for the people. But I think my main concern when you said high-paying jobs is that if the funds are there, if the revenue is there, we can do that. But I'm concerned that at times that's not the case. So I hope I answered your question.
Thank you. Ms. Verde Alegra?
You can call me Rosanna for sure.
Oh, please. Thank you. Actually, I'm going to call all of you by your first names now.
I love that.
Okay? We've moved on.
Yes.
We're friends.
Absolutely.
Thank
yes.
you.
So how do I bring higher-paying jobs here in the city? You know, there's a business sector, there's the private sector, and there's the private sector. In the last couple of years, we have opened 100 new businesses in Vallejo. So those brought jobs to Vallejo. And they are, you know, from restaurants and small businesses, because really the source of good-paying jobs is small businesses. Sure, we all want to work in San Francisco and pay and get more pay, but we pay for commute, right, and our time. So the Faraday future is something that I'm looking forward to. I am really very hopeful that those negotiations will come to fruition, because if it does, then that's hundreds of high-paying jobs, both technical, marketing, sales, etc. And also, we need to partner with Solano Economic Development Corporation, because they are in the know of how we develop jobs, not just locally, but regionally, because it's not just in Vallejo. There are other jobs in the other cities in Vallejo, and that's perfectly okay, too. Thank you.
Thank you, Roseanne. Bob, you're next.
Thank you. This particular topic is very big on my list of accomplishments of what I want to do when I become mayor. First and foremost, what we need to look at are getting the trades to become involved in our community. Trades for our young people. Those that are not going to go to college, those that have no desire to go to college, but want a job. So let's look at the trades. And there are trade academies all over the country. We can bring one here to employ our young people. Another thing that I would like to do, Councilmember Verde Aliga just mentioned it, that Faraday Futures is a possibility. Why can't we have internship programs with companies that are high on the technology rating, folks that want to bring technology to our community? I've spoken to some of the leaders of Faraday Future, and what they have told me is they are very interested in bringing internships to the city of Vallejo for our young people. We need to also partner with our colleges, our hospitals, and local businesses to employ our young people to provide sustainable, solid jobs for their future. Thank you.
Thank you. We are now on to the lightning round. And the lightning round is got four questions rather than three. And everyone gets to answer. And I get to choose who goes first, apparently. Okay? So I is it scary? Nah. Okay. So question number seven is, or question number one out of the lightning round is, so I'm going to say it first and then I'm just going to throw a dart. At 6:30, 2014, don't worry, at 6:30, 2014, the city's unfunded pension obligation was $223 million. Pension costs are 60% of salaries for public safety employees and 34% of salaries for other employees. Do you think these costs are reasonable and sustainable? And if not, how would you reduce them? So just to remind you of the numbers, $223 million, 60% public safety, 34% is salaries of other employees. And what we're going to do is just go down the line.
I have to move from that dart. The employee salaries and the pensions is one of the things that brought us into bankruptcy, is because we continue to pay high salaries and then we're not paying attention to the pensions and the health care that we're having to pay into. One of the things that we looked at as a board member on GVRD is that we made sure that we took from the budget that we had enough money that we put aside extra funding.
This is a complicated question, so I think we'll allow you a minute instead of 15 seconds on this particular question.
Okay. And you know what? Because you were pulled out of your stride, we're going to start all over again. You get an extra 20 seconds. Let's start again. Go on.
Okay, so one of the things that we need to make sure that when we're going into negotiation with contracts, that we're always mindful that we're trying to put down the amount of money that we owe. We also have to make sure that we have in the budget amount of money that we're putting aside so that we're making sure that we pay for those pensions that we've already promised to the people. But we really have to strive to make sure that we're starting to look at what we're paying our employees and whether or not it's sustainable within the budget that we have. We want to have good police officers, we want to have good firefighters, we want to have good employees, but we want to make sure that we can afford to pay for them and that in the future that we're not going back down the road of bankruptcy.
Contract negotiations is a very touchy subject, and as a union member for over 20 years at Contra Costa County, I have seen my fair share of layoffs, strikes, furloughs, both voluntarily and mandatory furloughs, paying $890 a month for insurance, so I know what it is to receive a cutback. I think that the city needs to be able to negotiate contracts that are sustainable. Although I do commend the public safety for all the work they do, they put their life on the line every single day, and not all of us would do that. I also think that we need to be able to balance a budget, and if at any time there's reductions that are made to either salaries or pensions, it needs to be done in a fair way where everybody can contribute some of what they receive, so that we don't have what happened last time where we had IBEW that received such a large reduction in their benefits and others did not. I think that it's fair to say that we want to compensate everybody according to what they do, but at the same time, if the funds are not there, you're limited. You're put up against the wall and you have to make decisions, hard decisions that will be made.
It's neither sustainable nor very reasonable at this point. It's not sustainable because when I was on the budget advisory committee for a city manager and as a bankruptcy lawyer, I argued against it twice before, but nobody paid any attention. We're going to have to continue to be very, very controlling on what we spend and what we agree to spend. We would love to reduce our salaries, but the reality is that in the labor market, you can't reduce them. You're going to have to at least be able to hold the line on them. Otherwise, you'll drive good employees away. The city has enough difficulty attracting qualified top management today. Our pension plan, we have set up a plan to address where it will be reduced over a period of 29 years, like a long-term mortgage. It will get there, but it's going to take a long ways to do it. To make it faster, we're either going to have to float a bond issue to reduce it, as some cities have done, or more hopefully, convince a governor to appoint people to PERS board who won't go wild with the numbers they require from city. We can solve some of it at the local area, but a lot of it has to be solved at the state level as well, and that's where it becomes a state issue. So please talk to your state legislators, and especially the governor, in the next election.
You can only slice this pie so many ways, and before you know it, the pie is non-existent. In other words, there's no money. This whole issue scares me. As a public safety employee who has retired from the city of Vallejo, yes, I look at our budget. As a city council member, I look at our budget and say, okay, this is a huge amount each year that is going out to our unions for retirement, for CalPERS. Is there an alternative? And I say, yes, there is an alternative. Number one, we can look at privatization of retirement programs and try to cut our costs. Unfortunately, if we try to drop PERS overnight, that is going to cost us hundreds of millions of dollars. So as Councilmember McConnell has said, yes, we do have a payoff plan, and it's working. It's slow. I would agree with that. It's going to take 29 years. But as a council member, we need to toe the line. We need to hold our costs. We need to hold our benefits back, because everything else suffers, because that pie can only get cut so many ways, and then the pie is no longer existent.
Thank you. Our current situation is not sustainable. Under the current Measure B, when those funds drop off, you're going to find that we can't afford to keep operating the way we are. We would have to lay off people immediately. So, and then you throw in the infrastructure needs that we have that are not funded appropriately, we really have a problem. The problem's not going to be solved by taking one course of action. It's going to require multiple actions. One is to make sure you negotiate properly and don't pay out more than you can afford. Two is to grow the economy so that you can increase your revenue side. And three is you're going to have to campaign hard for Measure V. Measure B cannot be a temporary tax. Unfortunately, to sustain our standards, we're going to have to make it permanent. Thank you.
One of the main responsibilities of the city is fire protection and police protection of its citizens. That is very, very important to me. However, I also support making sure that the budget is balanced and that these contracts with our police and fire and all other employees is sustainable. So we are still in the process of negotiating with our three employee groups, and I'm looking forward to making that happen. However, it will not happen by the end of this year. So the other issue too also is setting aside money for our liability, the pension amount. That concerns me. However, our city has set aside in the last 3 years monies to set aside for that amount, for that liability retirement pension. And also we have $13.7 million in reserves. That has not happened in the last 10 years. So this council has worked towards making sure that we make that we have a reserve in our budget as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, the next three questions are, the time limit is 15 seconds. Yeah, it's very quick. And we're gonna start with you, Roseanne, and go straight down the line. 15 seconds. Over, it's finished. No.
And then.
Okay, question is, are you in favor of a ballot measure to put binding arbitration back in the city charter?
It was rejected by voters in the past. I don't mind putting it back on the ballot and have the voters decide. Thank you.
That was 3 seconds. You did well. Okay.
No, I'm not in favor of putting binding arbitration back on the ballot, but I don't have a closed mind on the subject. If someone comes up with a proposal that makes sense, then let the citizens decide.
No, it's already been decided. Why do we need to put it back on the ballot again? There's absolutely no reason for that.
Emphatically, no. I'm one of the ones who helped take it to where we couldn't have it on the ballot. That's one of the reasons this city went into bankruptcy, and if it's returned, the same thing will happen. I can guarantee you that, plus it'll open up a lot of people who have been very desirous of more wages. It will ruin this city. Thank you.
I'm also not in favor of binding arbitration, and this is a question that came up at an endorsement interview that I had, and I made it very clear that I wasn't in favor. And I'll try and be very quick with this. My example that I gave was if I had $10,000 and my husband said, I'm going to take that and fix the car that we have in the garage. And I said, no, we're going to take those $10,000 and fix the kitchen. It's not fair for anybody else to come in without knowing our finances, knowing our situation, to come in and tell us what to do with the $10,000.
As one of the citizens that worked very hard to collect signatures to try to put this on the ballot to get rid of binding arbitration, of course, I would not be in favor of putting it back on. One of the things that the council is voted into office for is that the people are depending on us to make a decision on how the money is spent, so it shouldn't go to somebody arbitrarily to make a decision for the people.
Thank you. Okay, question number two. Are you in favor of a strong mayor form of government? Anyone want to take that on first?
Yes. Absolutely not. It's not broken. Why do we need to fix it? We have had this form of government, city manager, city council form of government for years. It's in our charter. Are we going to change the charter? Are we going to say one person controls the budget? Are we going to say one person controls the entire city? Absolutely not. This is a city council, city manager form of government. It works. Thank you.
Okay. How about, hold on, you guys. Let's not clap. Who wants to give me an alternative to that opinion? No? No? All of you agree? All of you agree? Okay, then let's move on to another question. Okay, so all of you agree strong mayor is not appropriate in Vallejo? Yes? Not heads. Go on. Excellent. Okay. Number three. Question number three, 15 seconds each person. Is it appropriate for city council members to use private email for city business? Okay. Who wants to start that?
No.
Okay.
We've got private email for city business, no.
Okay.
Big time no, plus we shouldn't be able to have access to our emails and our iPads and our computers while we're on the dais. There needs to be an ethics opinion adopted by this city, and we need to follow it.
Okay.
Absolutely not. It's discoverable. If somebody wants to know what's being said, they can take my Yahoo account and look into it. And what's in that account is my personal business. Not everybody's in the room.
I don't see any reason to having your personal email and using it for city business. There's an email account that's going to be given to you. Use that, because you have to be transparent. There's no reason to use otherwise.
Okay.
I think Hillary has given us a good reason not to use personal accounts. We're to make sure that we are transparent and that the information that we're passing on is available to anybody who is inquiring about what our messaging is on email.
1 minute. Only one? Okay, we're now coming to the questions that the city, the audience has given us. What I'd like to say is, can we not clap or say anything? Just because I can't hear anything, okay?
So they have 1 minute, 45
seconds. Okay, and you've got 1 minute.
Oh. Everybody answers.
And everybody answers, okay? And question number one, how do you justify supporting Measure V when taxpayers were promised the hike in sales tax would be temporary and not used for ongoing expenses? We'll start with Rosanna and go down the line.
Good, and this will be my last, because I have to leave for the other forum, so just to
okay.
let you folks know.
You got it.
Okay. Thank you. I am supporting.
I want to say thank you for coming, actually.
Absolutely.
That's very nice of you to come.
It's a pleasure to
thank
be here.
Thank you.
I have to go to another forum just to let folks know. So I support Measure V. I'm one of the six council members that voted to put it on this November ballot. For the reason, and Measure V's intent is to take the sunset clause away from Measure B, because Measure B ends 2022. So Measure V will pay for our services, police protection and fire protection, but not for salaries and benefits. And there's also going to be monies for our roads, because we do want to repair our roads. There's a lot of roads that have been fixed in the last, you know, few years. About 137 road miles have been paved, but we know that we have a problem with fixing our roads and infrastructure. So I do support Measure V, and hopefully you will do that too. And again, let the voters decide. Okay?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Before we go on to you, Bill, I want to say, could we give a thank you to Roseanne for coming, because that's really wonderful. Thank you. Thank you. Okay.
Okay. I don't know that I'm going to be able to, and don't even know that I want to, try to justify based on the question, because it was, Measure B was talked about in the sense that it would be temporary. What I want to convey to the citizens is that without Measure V, if that Measure B money goes away, we have not grown the economy or altered our budget position in a way to sustain our city functions at this time. So the justification, I guess, would be is that we have to have it. We have to have the revenue to run the city. Now, whether we've made all the right moves since Measure B passed to the present, no, we haven't. And I don't mean to say that people haven't been trying, but it hasn't worked out. So we need Measure V to sustain services at a level that you all to have the community you want.
My concern is this, is that number one, our economy hasn't improved to the point that we're able to restructure our budget to provide the services that this community requires. We have a long way to go in road repair, infrastructure repair, the problems we're having with our buildings, and until we get to that point, we are going to struggle. Measure V, as in Victor, as in Vallejo, is very important to keep our community alive and well, to keep the services that you are receiving now up and running. If we lose on Measure V, we're going to have to make some very tough choices. Are we going to cut back on public works programs? Are we going to cut back on employees? Are we going to have to cut back on public safety? And those are my concerns. I do not want to see this happen to our community. I do support Measure V. I wish there was a way we could have structured our budget in a way that we can move us forward in the way it needs to go. Thank you.
I'm the one who voted against putting it on the ballot, and I did so because we're 4 years into a 10-year program. Fairfield has an extension of their sales tax coming up. They're 2 years away from sending it. I think if we take away that limitation now, we're taking the pressure off city council people to be financially responsible. We're saying you don't have to look for those hard decisions, that way to finance the city, the way to grow the economy. You can now have this money forever. You can put it back into the budget, and everybody will be making demands for it. I'm not against having the sales tax, but I think it's premature to ask the voters to give it to it. The promise was that it would be a 10-year plan. Well, why don't we stick to the 10 years, and when we get within 2 years or 4 years, then see where we are rather than putting it on there now. You give that money to the city council people, you better make sure you've got financially responsible people on that council, because they'll use it. Believe me, they will. Thank you.
Yes, I am in favor of Measure V. I think that at this point, given the situation that our city is in, we need all the help that we can get. And that's been generating revenue that's paid for a lot of things. Unfortunately, it hasn't been used for a lot of what it was intended for. So we need to make sure that the money that's received for the sales tax is used to fix our streets, and it's used for a lot of the services that we need. I think that we will get a city council that's responsible in this election. I have a lot of faith that people are going to make the right decisions and put people up there that will make those hard decisions that Mr. McConnell's talking about. And when that time comes and those decisions are made, then we will have more money to be able to utilize in the city for other services and continue to make this city the city that we all deserve. But at this point right now, I am in favor of Measure V because it's needed and it's the only thing that's been keeping us alive right now.
I am in favor of Measure V because of the fact that we're going to have those funds in order to continue moving the city forward. I think when we put Measure B in place, there was an assumption from the people that within 10 years that our budget was going to be at such that you wouldn't have to renew it and that we would absorb that cost into the general fund from the revenues that were coming in, and that didn't happen. It's a slow recovery, so we still need to have those funds. The things that I'm disappointing is that we have so many salaries that are based on Measure B. So if Measure V does not succeed, that means we lose all of those positions that we have now that people have started to count on. So we need to stop going back and forth and putting salaries onto these measures if we're not going to be able to put them into the general fund without including them in another budget. So I'm hoping that when we finally get to the end of this Measure B, that they've absorbed those positions into the general fund, that we've had enough revenue to do so, so that we're not threatening the citizens that if the measure doesn't succeed, that we're going to lose people, we're going to lose our police and fire. And that's the thing that concerns people the most.
Thank you. The next question, I want to caution everybody about the next question, because I want you to think about whether how this would affect you if you're still on the city council and whether you'd have to recuse yourself if you answer. So if you don't want to answer, I think the audience might understand. On the other hand, we'd love to hear your opinion. Or maybe it's a good idea to give your opinion on other people's answers if you don't want to recuse yourself. The question is, are you in favor or opposed to the cement factory? Bill, shall we start with you?
I haven't made up my mind on the cement factory. As I spoke earlier about having a process within a community as we try to attract business to this city, I believe we need to stick to the process. And at the end of the process, those people who you have put in place to represent you will have to vote and make the best decision they can for the community. I would like to say, though, that I have never and will never make a decision that puts our citizens at an unreasonable risk. And unreasonable is anything that would be detrimental to their health. So I'm going to look at the reports. I've already read the draft EIR, and I will follow the process, and I will vote for what I think is best for this city at the appropriate time.
We knew this question would be here. I think all of us did. First, we have been cautioned, we that are sitting on city council have been cautioned by our city attorney as to how we should speak regarding VMT Orsum. And the reason behind that is that we could say something that could be used against us in any kind of legal challenge. We could say something that would cause us to be recused and so that our voices would not be heard. My position is this. I've read both the DEIR and I asked for the EJA, the Environmental Justice Analysis. I was adamant that I wanted to see what is being said that would be effective to our community. My concern is this. I'm concerned for the well-being of our residents. I'm concerned for the well-being of a disenfranchised neighborhood, which is South Vallejo. More importantly, where is this business going to take us? How good is it for our community? What will it give us? What will it provide for us? I have not formed an opinion. However, after reading the DEIR and the EJA, all it has done is posed more questions for me. Thank you.
I'm in agreement with what my two colleagues to my left have said so far, but let me add to that. Having sat on the Planning Commission for 8 years, I know that applications can and do change during that process. And until you hear the application itself from the applicant, you don't know the final form. It's already changed forms several different times. When the draft environmental impact report was drafted, I prepared a lot of additional questions that have yet to be answered. They're supposed to be due 3 weeks before the December 19th Planning Commission hearing. So I want to see what those answers to those questions are. I think they'll bring out a lot of information that will shed some definitive opinions by the public as well as the people on council and the Planning Commission as to the quality or the lack of that project. But I will never support anything which endangers our citizens either. I do believe, though, that since we do have a process and they've put $975,000 into that process already, that we have to go through it to give them some respect, because when the next applicant comes, whether you like the project or not, if they look back and say, you didn't treat that applicant fairly, we've already lost on that future application.
I'm going to give you the answer that I've been giving whenever this comes up, which has been at every single forum. I think that it's important that we attract business to Vallejo. We allow them to establish, grow, and contribute to the community. This particular project, however, very much concerns me. It's going to be established in an area that's a very low-income, neglected area of the city. I'm concerned of its proximity to the elementary school. It's only a couple of blocks from there. I'm concerned with the traffic that they're going to have. I'm concerned with the pollutions. I'm concerned with the noise. There's a lot of concerns, but the situation has to be looked at in a fair way. Anybody that's trying to come to Vallejo and open a business should be given an equal opportunity, and they're no different. So let's let the process go through. Let's see what city the Planning Commission decides. And then at that point, the decision will be made by City Council. At no time would I put the money or anything else before the well-being of a community. I think that it's very, very important that people understand that we are not a dumping ground, that Vallejo has a lot of pride. We have a lot of people here that care. And jobs are important, yes, but lives are more important. Thank you.
As part of a community group that's been working on this from the time that we first heard about it, we had study groups that we pulled apart the DEIR and looked at the information. We looked at the type of pollutants that would be affecting this neighborhood. I think that what's important to say is that this neighborhood has been neglected historically. And for us to put a factory there that's going to bring in 200 trucks a day to that neighborhood that has a ship that's idle there 7 days a week, it's really hard to understand how that would be a benefit to the city as a whole. I think we really need to look at the fact that that part of town has the highest asthma rates in anywhere in Solano County. That means that the children are already suffering from pollution that they receive that comes from the freeway and it comes off of from the refineries. We want to make sure that any decision that we make is not going to be detrimental to any part of the city. We want to make sure that we're protecting the citizens, and it's not just putting jobs over health, because we should be able to make a choice that health overrides jobs in the city.
Thank you. Next question is, how will you deal with the homeless problem in Vallejo? Ms. Diaz, would you start, and then we'll go down the line, and then we'll end with you, Ms. Leah.
The homeless problem in Vallejo is very important and dear to me. I think that a lot of these people that are out there didn't choose yesterday that they wanted to be homeless or become addicted to drugs or have a mental instability. So we can't keep on turning our head the other way. We have to be able to help them. And although the city does not have the resources per se that they need, we need to have the county step in. I feel that Solano County has not taken interest in Vallejo as much as it should. And it should step up and contribute either matching funds or whatever we need to have to be able to address that issue. There's already a center on Sonoma that's a navigation center that Vallejo Together put together, and it's working quite well. People are able to go there, shower, eat, you know, try and get their lives back together. So that, along with mental health counseling, which we also have workshops at the Centro Latino where we work with a lot of these mental health problems that are going on in our community. So I think it's time that we step up and start taking care of our own.
It's probably an impossible problem to solve by a city. It does require regional cooperation with not only the county, but the state and the federal government as well. Utah has elected to purchase apartment buildings, rehabilitate them, and put people into them. That's one way of doing it. It's rather expensive, and it doesn't solve the whole problem, because a lot of the problems do relate to mental illness. Studies show about 20% of the people don't want to come off the streets no matter what, but that means 80% of them do. A lot of them are vets, like I'm a vet, and we have a very excellent homeless program through the VA Martinez that, if we can channel vets into, helps them. For the rest of us, we're going to have to address the issue of housing. The homeless comes because we don't have enough housing in this state, And in a high-priced area like Vallejo, that means we're going to have to get serious about what type of housing we have, where we're going to put it, what it's going to look like, and how we're going to finance it. But unless we solve the housing problem for everybody, we're not going to address the homeless problem either.
Mr. McConnell, I'm going to ask Mr. McConnell to clarify what he means about solving the housing problem.
We're not building enough houses. We haven't had a housing application in the city of Vallejo since at least 2008. The houses that you see being built today were approved by the city back then. Then we went into the Great Recession, and the developers withdrew their processes. Some of them have come back to renew their licenses before the Planning Commission. Some of them are still coming in under the old programs. But the reality is we haven't attracted any housing for almost 9 years now. And we have to address that. But we're built out here in Vallejo. We can do infill, which definitely needs to be done, but that's much more expensive. So that means we're going to have to give financial inducements as a city to people to do infill development. The rest of it's going to have to come from a different type of housing than we've ever had before, and we need to look at where, how, and when.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. McConnell. Does anyone want to answer Mr. McConnell's point there? We'll give you 15 seconds.
I think Mr. McConnell has brought up a very interesting issue, the fact that we do need more housing, more affordable housing. However, I'm looking at, say, let's building up. Maybe we need to start going into high-rise type of buildings, 6, 8, 10-story buildings, affordable housing that is going to be easy for our residents to move into, something that is affordable, something that is sustainable, something that might even provide services. So I'm very excited to think that that could be a future. But I'd like to go on with the homeless issue unless...
The homeless issue is one that we've seen in major cities across this country that they've struggled and spent millions and millions of dollars to try to solve and have not solved it. To think that Vallejo could provide in any way housing for those people that are on the streets, or that those people who are on the street would have the revenue at any price that we could bring to them, that's not going to happen. So I don't know the solution, but that is not the solution. It is regional. It is a regional problem. And it, for the most part, it's a mental health problem. And that problem was set on California a long time ago. And we need to address that at a state level to get these folks into a situation that is paid for by the whole state, and because a community cannot do it.
Mr. Sampaio, I'm going to give you 15 seconds.
Could I use that 1 minute on the way I understood it was I was supposed to respond to Mr. McConnell's question for 15 seconds,
absolutely.
And now I would like to respond to the initial question of homelessness.
Right.
May I do
corrected.
That?
Of course.
Thank you very much.
So this is a 1 minute question.
This is a 1 minute.
This is a 1 minute question.
Yes.
Oh boy. Okay.
Oh boy. Yes. See, you would have gotten a 1 minute question if you had been not so uppity. No.
Oh my. William, really?
I apologize.
I like this guy.
Okay. Okay, Bob.
Okay. Okay, let me get back into the game face here. Homelessness. I've been a homeless advocate prior to being elected to city council back in 2011. I advocated for homeless. I've helped with the homeless. I've looked for programs to help the homeless. After I was elected, I asked Mayor Davis at the time, can I specifically become involved with the homeless issue? He said yes. Okay, yes, it is a global issue. It is huge. We don't just have it here in Vallejo. We have it nationwide. We have it worldwide. What can we do here in Vallejo? My first thought was we need a navigation center. We need a day center where we can bring homeless folks to, where they can wash their clothes, where they can take a shower, where they can get a haircut, where they can get clean, where they can get sober, where on top of that, there are services that are there that are provided for them that are mental health issues, that are medical issues, a way to get vets over to the hospital on the other side of Mare Island to get them to Martinez. I'm really concerned about our veterans. So yes, I believe that we are not doing enough, and my hope is that in the future we can provide countywide and through the state. And yes, Jane, I see you waving stop.
Okay. Thank you. Would you? Yes?
I just want to add that we already have a navigation center. It's on Sonoma in Florida, and that center serves that purpose. There's computers there for those that are trying to get their lives back together. So there's showers, there's washers and dryers, there's food that's donated, a couch. I mean, I'm helping with that program. I think what we need also is a homeless shelter. We need a place. I know that we have one already, but we should have another homeless shelter, because there's a lot of people out there that are living in their cars. And it's not just vets or single people. These are families with kids that are living in their cars, and these kids are expected to succeed in school. They go to school, and they're expected to perform at the same level as all the other children, and that's very difficult to do.
Thank
you. Sorry, I could go on forever.
Yeah,
sorry.
No, I can understand. Leah, did you get a chance to answer that question? Okay, then. Whoa.
One of the things that we've been observing for some time in the city of Vallejo is that we need to really start putting pressure on the county, because the county is where the money comes from to take care of these issues. It seems like we've always been the stepchild for Solano County, and we don't hold them more accountable for making sure that we get our share of the funds. We have the biggest population here, and we have a high population of homeless. So it seems like as long as they keep it in Vallejo, then it's okay, because it'll keep it out of the other cities that are in the county. And we really need to make sure that we hold them accountable for the services. They have shop workshops that for mentally ill and for other services, and they have them in Fairfield. How are the people in Vallejo supposed to get there? So we really need to make sure that we're going to put these services here, and that we make sure that the county pays attention to Vallejo, and that we're at the table every time that they have the budget session, that make sure that we're getting our fair share of services to make sure that we can help these people. Mentally ill people have to have medical services here in Vallejo that are accommodating for the type of things that they need. We can't expect them to get on a bus and go to Fairfield to get the services they need and then have to come back to Vallejo and don't have those services available.
Thank you. Okay, next question. Bill, we're going to start with you. Okay, and then we'll go down the line. Question is, assuming you win, what is your goal for your first year, your first goal, your most important goal?
The first thing I would want to do, and the most important thing I could do if elected mayor of the city of Vallejo, would be to create a relationship with my fellow council members that would allow us to pull together for the city of Vallejo. Far too many times in a governance situation, it becomes adversarial, and you are unable to accomplish any of the things that the citizens would like you to accomplish, or the ones that you walked around town talking about for a year trying to get elected. So that would be my first priority, would be to establish a relationship with the board and the city, with the council and the city manager, in order to accomplish not only my goals, but the goals of that they bring to the table also.
So you're planning on being a peacekeeper?
Not at all.
Mr. Sampayan, what are you going to say about that?
Oh, now it's Mr. Sampayan.
Yes.
Wow, okay.
Go on, Bob.
Okay, I've been demoted. My first goal is consensus building. That is what a mayor is responsible for. You cannot have a council that is so divided that people are working against each other. We need to come together to make our community a strong community. And with divisiveness, it doesn't work. I've seen it my past 4 years on council, and it is a struggle sometimes to work with folks that are against you, that for whatever reason, be it political or they don't like you, it's very difficult. My second, and I think overwhelming goal, is a community engagement program. What I want is a mayor's advisory group. I want to pull together maybe 18, maybe 20 people in the community, not yes people, but people who will bring solid issues to my desk that say, this is what's going on in our community. This is what needs to be addressed. Because what I'm about is bringing our community together and working together to make Vallejo a better place. Thank you.
My continuing goal is to improve roads, but that's a continuing one. My new and first goal for next year will be transparency and openness, because we don't have enough of it in the city of Vallejo today, neither between council and staff, nor council and mayor. Currently, as an example, Soltrans is attended to by the mayor and one council member. We don't receive adequate reports from them. We don't receive adequate reports from the mayor as to what happens in Washington, D.C. on the mayor's conferences. We don't get a lot of information. I asked for it once, and you know what I get now? I get a watch commander's report from the mayor's office. That's the openness that he extends to. So I've already told the gentleman running for mayor that they either open up their office and all the information that goes through it to the council and to the rest of the city manager's office on an as-needed basis, or we're going to start using the records request under the government code and to get that information, because it's got to be more open. It's not providing for the exchange of information, which is the genius of a city manager council form of government, where with seven people at 50 years average age, you've got 350 years of experience instead of 50 years and one mayor. So we need to open it up and get that exchange going and use that process.
I think one of my first goals would be to be able to bring community engagement forward. I think that we have a very divided city council, and everybody needs to put their differences aside and personal agendas aside and be able to work together for the betterment of the city. Now, with community engagement, I mean, we need to be representative of everybody. Every single voice in Vallejo needs to be heard, and I don't think that that has been done up until now. So we need to engage everybody, we need to be able to work with them, we need to be able to see what services they need and how we can provide them. With that being said, I think that, you know, building new, working with the current businesses that we have, the small businesses, and allowing other businesses to come into Vallejo and establish themselves is the next important thing, because that's going to generate the revenue that we need to be able to fix those roads and be able to continue paying salaries and to put programs in place that are going to be working with the community. So I think my first goal is to engage everyone and have everybody's voice be heard, and that's not been the case.
One of the things that I think is most important for City Council is that we do build more transparency into city government, and that we make information available to the community. The city has started to have a better system now to get information out to the public, the city manager's report, put newsletters out, but we need to do more on that, because it's amazing to find out when you're going out and walking the precincts and talking to the people, how little people actually know about what decisions are being made for them and are going to impact them. So they really need to have more engagement with the community. I think it's an easy process to do if you set up a situation where you can get information to people and invite people in to really hear what they have to say, and then take into account what they want to have done and to your decision-making process. So we really need to have more transparency. I think that the information needs to flow from the city manager's office to city council, and it shouldn't be held in one place, and then someone decides who gets what information, because that leads to the division that we have on council.
Thank you. I want to go back to Mr. Sampayan's mayor advisory board and Mr. Pendergrass, or Bill and Bob. Sorry. Bill, what did you think of that idea of a mayor's advisory board? And would you like to have that too? And would you want Bob to invite you to be on his board? And vice versa? No?
No, thanks. Bob and I are very close friends, but I actually disagree on that. I would not want to have a mayor's advisory board. I believe the entire community is my advisory board, and if anyone has an issue, I have an open door policy. My phone number is in the phone book. You can come down to City Hall, you can email me, and I will take your input at any time. And quite frankly, you could come down to the city council meeting and speak in front of all of us, so we all hear the same thing at the same time, and we can interact and react in a way that best represents our community.
Okay. Bob, 2 seconds.
Coming down to council to speak in front of us does not allow us, the council, to respond to your questions. It doesn't happen. When I see a mayor's advisory board, I'm hoping for people from all over the community. I'm hoping that folks from North Vallejo, South Vallejo, East and West Vallejo, different communities, the Asian, the African American, the Hispanic community, the LGBTQ community, comes to me with their issues so I can talk to them. Of course I have an open door policy.
Okay, thank you.
I could go on and on.
Yeah, absolutely. Anyone want to raise their hand to join the mayor's advisory board if it comes up? Raise your hand. Who's interested? Go on, raise your hand higher. Okay, so you've got a lot of people interested. Well done. Okay. And I'm sure Bill is interested too. Yes. Okay. So we're down to the finish line. 1 minute to talk about... One and a half minutes to talk about anything you want. Who'd like to start? Closing statements. 1.5 minutes. Anything.
I would just like to, first of all, thank you for being here and for listening to us and taking up part of your Sunday. Appreciate that very much. If elected, I will do my very best to move Vallejo forward. My goals are public safety, education, and economic growth. I will work hard to meet the challenges that those three areas represent. I can tell you I ran, with my wife's help, a business in Vallejo for 40 years. I know what it's like to make a payroll. I know what it's like to deal with regulation. I know what it's like to run a business. I know that we need to hire more policemen. Vallejo is not a safe place. That's not me just saying that. There's data to support that. We need more policemen on the streets, police people, not just men, sorry. And then as far as education, I'm on the campus every day. I took a job at Vallejo High School so that I could be on the campus every day. I'm with 1,500 of our children to understand what it's like for them and what it's like in those schools. So I would appreciate your vote in November. And if you look on my website, you can get a greater insight to what I have to say and what I plan to do for this community.
Before we go to you, Bob, does everyone agree that Vallejo is not a safe place? Okay, let's move on. Bill?
Do you want me to answer that question?
Yeah.
One of the things that we have in Vallejo that is difficult for all of us is image. We have an image that people have said is negative. I hate that. And one of the things that I plan to do as your mayor is change that image, because I'm proud of our town, and I bet you everyone in this room is proud of this town. And if we don't go out and say, we are Vallejo proud, we are Vallejo strong, we will continue to have that image.
Okay.
Okay, I'm off my soapbox.
You're off your soapbox. No, enough.
Now, can I use my...
I have 2 seconds I'm the one that said it first.
I'm sorry, it's really quite important for me personally, so I'm taking that. I like the idea of Vallejo's safe.
It's important to me personally, too, and the facts bear out what I said. Look at the crime data and compare it to any other community. That has nothing to do with my pride in this community. Our family's been here over 100 years, and I'm one of the proudest people you'll ever meet in terms of my pride for Vallejo. But to say the streets are not unsafe or that they are safe is just to be turning a blind eye. Look at the data and understand the situation, and then you can work to correct it. Vallejo is a wonderful place, but the streets are not safe right now.
Thank you. Let's go back to the topic at hand and the 1.5 minutes to talk about anything you want.
Okay, thank you very much. And I appreciate what my colleague here has said. I really do. I have served Vallejo for over 3 decades. I've served it as not only a police officer, but an area commander running a substation downtown, dealing with quality of life issues and solving quality of life issues for this community. I've been a crime prevention specialist. I put together 350 neighborhood watch programs around this community when we were down to 73 police officers. I did that so we could improve our quality of life and our safety. I've also served as your city council member for the past 4.5 years, making some real tough decisions, establishing policy, working to attract business, improving quality of life. Look at my voting record, folks. Look what I have done for this community. My experience has helped me in establishing relationships with local, state, and federal government. I can navigate through the bureaucracy that we have. I also have a vision, and that vision, part of my vision, is the general plan that you, the residents of Vallejo, have put together. And it is so important to me that we follow that general plan. If we don't follow that plan, or if we take an inexperienced group of people and allow them to run it, it's going to fall apart. It's like building a house. If you don't have good quality builders, what are you going to get at the end of the program? I'm going to work to create dialogue and education and business for our youth. I'll continue to improve public safety with current technology, and I will stop. Again, thank you very much for being here. Thank you to Citizens for Vallejo and all of you that have come out on a Sunday for this event. Thank you.
Indeed, thank you all for being here. My vision of Vallejo is very much reflected by the general plan that I fought very hard to implement, but it goes beyond that. I want to talk about the community policing program first, which is the Safe Streets. We paid a lot of money because we had a police department that believed only in suppression. That has to change. It has started to change, and it's changing into community policing. Community policing is not only intervention, which is where they get to the problem before it occurs, but prevention, which is where they go into the community and earn the trust of the residents, so they'll make those phone calls to head off the type where they can only go out and suppress it. That's the most expensive form of policing there is. And to grow our police force, we need to do it gradually with reserve on financial control. But it has to happen because it will cut down the crime rate, which will give us ability to grow economically as well. Part of it's with the school district. That is almost the most important race in this city this year, because a lot of our crime does come from our local residents, and they learn that in the school districts. San Francisco has recently done studies to show the correlation between people who are incarcerated and the parents and the children who start becoming involved in criminal activities, and the numbers are astonishing. So that's a big point, one I'm going to be pushing for, as well as the transparency. I've got a background in public administration, graduate work, undergraduate, worked at the federal, the state level. I've been a county prosecutor. I've worked for the U.S. Court of Appeals, and I've learned how government works. So I'm last on the ballot, but first for Vallejo.
I'd like to let you know that I've lived in Vallejo for over 32 years. I'm the proud mother of 3 millennials and the grandmother of a 1.5-year-old that's also calling Vallejo his home. I'm the founder and the director of Diaz and Loera Centro Latino, which is a community organization here in town that serves the community to help them become civic engagement and also provide them resources. The police department received a grant lately that was $480,000 and is partnering with 3 different entities, New Dawn, Kaiser, and the Centro Latino. So we're already working with them to do community policing. I'm on the Chief of Police Advisory Board, so we're developing different strategies to be able to continue to do the community policing that's been working so far. I'm also part of the design and implementation of a program at both Vallejo High School and Jesse Bethel High School that goes live next month. This program is going to work with the kids to help them be able to graduate, to increase our graduation rates and make our schools better. These kids, a lot of them have not had an opportunity. They will be the first ones in their family to graduate from high school. I received the Achieve Award from United Way Bay Area for my efforts in fighting poverty. I've also been recognized by Contra Costa County for my efforts in fighting poverty. Received the Latina of the Year Award from the Hispanic Chamber. And I'm the recipient of the Latina Giving Circle, which is also a grant that we received for the Centro. I have vested interest in this city. I am not going anywhere. My family arrived in the U.S. when I was 5 years old from Mexico, and we had to leave everything behind because of economic problems and because of safety issues. I will fight for Vallejo, and I don't ask for your vote. I want to earn your vote the way I've earned everything in my life.
As somebody that's worked in this community for the last 20 years, going into neighborhoods to try to improve quality of life and self-sufficiency in those neighborhoods and making sure that the people had a voice in this community, I think it's really important that we continue to bring that civic engagement. and I intend to continue doing that once I get into the office. Somebody that has an idea about what people go through in a neighborhood when they have problems and then have to go to the city council and figure out how they get help and how do you have a voice in that town is really important. And I think that the experience that I have, because I've done that, is going to help me. I know that people are weary about going to city council and talking about issues. We need to make that more inviting for people to come there and that they can deal with the issues that are here. For the last 15 years, I've worked on the board of directors for the Greater Vallejo Recreation District. I know how to manage a budget. I know how to take care of the taxpayers' dollars and make sure that you get what you pay for and that you get the services that are available to you. So I want to make sure that we continue to be transparent in the city and that we're engaged with our community and that we have people on the council that are going to make sure that our general plan update continues forward and that we move in a better direction than we have and that we have a bright future in the city that everybody is proud of. We want to make sure that we're not just talking about having policing to get rid of the problems we have because we can hire all the police we want in the city. I've lived through a time where we've had the highest number of police officers on the force and we still had a high crime rate. What we need is for the revenues to come in to change this.
Oof, we're finished. A big